Fishing the DMV has big plans for the future, but to get there, I need your help. Our first Patreon goal is 100 Patreon subscribers for $6 a month, which is less than a pack of Senkos or a jackhammer chatterbait. For more information on our Patreon, please go check it out in the episode description down below. Thank you so much. You're listening to Fishing the DMV with your host, Thomas Ahrens. Fishing the DMV is brought to you by Jake's Bait and Tackle, located in Winchester, Virginia.
If that doesn't get you jacked up, I don't know what will.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to Monday Night Live. We have a really good show for you this week. I'm sorry for the way my face looks. I'm participating in No Shave November to help bring awareness for prostate cancer. We have a couple of housekeeping things to get through here before we get our big stud guest on. The number one is our Patreon supporter of the week is Clifton Bennett. Clifton, you just want a gift card to Jake's Bait and Tackle. If you guys would like to, please think about joining us on Patreon. Every week, I select an individual to be the Patreon winner of the week where they'll win a gift card. We also have a private Facebook group. Every Patreon supporter gets a discount off all their orders to Jake's Bait and Tackle. You'll get stickers. You'll get special content just for you, and you're going to really help us get to some of our Patreon goals, which includes creating a nonprofit to where we can go in and help support all these local fisheries with stocking programs. And without further ado, I'm going to bring on this guy, Tyler. Thank you so much for coming on the show. I think my mic is not working right now. So Tyler, you keep talking here while I get my mic figured out. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Let's see. Hopefully I don't know if my voice or my audio is messed up as well. So I've been out on the lake as much. I've been guiding. I had some personal things and some things come up with the boat that kept me from doing like trips as usual. In the summer and spring, I mean, I was out minimum 3 times, most of the time, pretty much from May through even like all through August, I was out 4 to 5 times a week. But now it's slowed down. I'm still on the lake and, you know, checking out on it, still fishing some tournaments here and there. So for the rest of this year, I'm being very selective with dates, and in the winter I'll still be pretty selective, but still running, you know, as normal. People are still reaching out to me and getting tips and stuff on the lakes. So that's what I've been up to. I actually had someone reached out to me and just wanted to know some basic locations and tips, because that's another service I offered. They ended up getting like second in their championship for whatever club tournament it was. I've been doing things like that and getting out in the water still while I can, but been very, very busy with a bunch of different life things. But the business is, you know, still running as normal. I still get people reaching out. A lot of it is, you know, information and that sort of thing. I'm getting to about as quick as I possibly can. And every time I've been going out there recently, it's been playing around with different baits, kind of doing different stuff. And then if I, you know, want to get back to catching them the way that I know how to catch them and, you know, the way I'm comfortable with, you know, I'll go do that and catch a few. But at this point, you know, I feel like I've, you know, gone through the lake so much, know so much of it, how I like to fish it, how it fits my strengths. So now it's like, I'll just go out there with something oddball, just something I don't really like doing. And you can see, you know, the fish are very pressured. So in situations that I've noticed, besides certain times in the spring, even in the fall, the shallow fish on Anna are just, they're typically just harder to catch. You can catch them, you know, a lot easier during these feeding windows and when the temperatures are dropping and when they are very aggressive. But to me, I'm still, for the most part, even here in the fall, sticking to, you know, a lot of more offshore, and I say that with a grain of salt. You know, I'm not in deep offshore water, shallow offshore water, catching them on a variety of different baits this time of year. This is a fun time of year too, especially even right now, because you can still get into, you know, it's a lot more moving bait type stuff. But again, any given day, depending on the conditions, the fish will tell you what they want on that lake.
Let's try this. How does this sound?
You sound better.
There we go. Isn't that great when you buy $2,000 worth of hardware and it decides not to work? That's why, guys, you have backup systems. Right to go. So let's try this again. Where the hell did we leave off?
I think everyone heard me. I don't know if I sound staticky, but I just kind of told them what I've been doing recently and just a very like basic kind of rundown of, you know, how the lake's been fishing when I've been out there recently.
Did you by chance, and it's okay if you didn't, did you see the John Odenkirk interview?
I have. No, I did not.
He mentioned some interesting things where he thinks in the next 5 to 6 years, it will always take, or there's a really good likelihood that it'll always take 25 pounds to win tournaments in the next 5 years because the F1s will have fully kicked in. They're still babies right now. And so all the weights, the dirty 30s you're seeing, those aren't really the F1s, which is insane to me to get confirmation from him about that. Like, what is your thought process of the weights it'll take to win the next 5 years?
On Anna and specifically, I think they're going to keep increasing. It's gone better. So like, as far as what I know, it still takes on some day, literally like 11 pounds on Anna can cash a check. Sometimes like 8 pounds can cash a check on Anna on like, you know, against people who fish it regular, but the winning weight, and especially if you really get on them or you get on something, for sure. And I think it's going to make more anglers skilled, and fishermen in general are getting better. And, you know, when more people start seeing the weights and stuff like Anna, they're going to go to Anna to fish those tournaments. You know, just guys that are, you know, just have more experience in general. And they're hearing all these good things about the F1s, Anna weights going up. So I think that in return, you're getting a better variety of anglers that are going to come to lakes like Anna. And you're getting this F1 program going up. I don't know how successful the F1 program really is. I hear so many mixed things about it. I'm not in a position to understand that, but I can tell you there's plenty of very big northern strain, you know, in Anna right now, where, yeah, I mean, again, if you're going against best, I mean, you need 18 pounds minimum to win a one day a tournament. And it's not, especially in the winter time when they're all stacked up in very specific areas, you know, that's when you see those really high 20s, those really high 30s. But for sure, in a few years, if everything keeps going how it's been for me the past couple of years, Anna's just been getting better and better. And I think, you know, winning weights will just keep on getting better as well.
The fall transition, guys, and then you guys, please let us know in the comment section down below how the audio is. Sorry about that. I really apologize. I feel like the fall transition is completely different at other places. And when I was running this morning at the gym, I was really thinking about this hard, where if you go from a marketing standpoint, you really think springtime in this area, March, April, maybe a little May, June, July, August would be your summertime. And then fall in the wintertime here is weird because calendar wise, November, December, January, February, 4 months for winter. But November is weird because on calendar, when you think Thanksgiving, when you think Christmas, it's wintertime. But are we still in the fall transition?
Yeah, for sure. I think it lingers here and especially when you see these temperatures and stuff like that. I mean, I don't think it depends. A cold front could come out of nowhere in late November and really push things to like that below 55 degree mark and into that mark where I think they do start moving, you know, more into their kind of winter holes and those, you know, steep banks and structures that are a little bit deeper. But I think it's still a fall bite. There's still fish plenty. I caught a fish in like 2 foot of water the other day, which for me is insane. If you ever fish with me or you've ever seen me fish, I don't fish shallow, unless I'm somewhere where like I have to, like I'm on a river system, for example. And I was just doing something different that I don't usually do. So there's fish everywhere right now. There is fish that are still pretty deep, and it takes a long time to get fish to start moving into the fall transition on Anna. I was catching fish that were still very schooled up summer, like chasing baits on offshore main lake stuff a few weeks ago. So I think you get a really long progression, and I almost look at it like the spawn. Not every single fish does the same thing at the same time. Not every single fish just starts doing a fall transition. It's hard to put it into words, but that lake stays the same so much. It doesn't really change once you figure it out. And there's fish like that are super residential there in areas where you wouldn't think that. And so like your classic fall transition, and a lot of this stuff is true, like the basics, like running back to feeder creeks for more oxygenated water that's just been depleted during the hot summer months. That 100% true. But that doesn't mean like you're running, you know, all the way into the back or contrary. Are the fish there? Yes. Are you running all the way back into these other, you know, big feeder creeks? Feeder creeks are all over the lake, on main lake. They're in the backs of certain pockets. some of them are just like little things that probably run off from a farm somewhere, but they're still bringing in oxygen. I think it varies. And I look at the fall transition, especially in Virginia where we are, as it's like the spawn. It doesn't happen all at once, not everywhere at the lake. Every lake is in a different transition. The fish are different behavior based on where they live. If there's resident fish, it's even weirder. That's kind of how I look at it.
I also like to put in there something else that I had an epiphany on. The two things I believe, and I could be wrong, guys, it's the daylight and then it's the water temperature. And if you think about it, when you're going into that September, October timeframe, no matter what, the days are going to get shorter. And I think that no matter what is the 100% the cue for the fall to start, because grass will start dying off when the light starts being shorter in the days. So the biggest wild card is, do we get a colder fall or do we get a warmer fall? Because if you have an Indian summer, I think 100%, like we did this year, it pushes off that fall transition until the daylight triggers. And you could make $1 million if you could figure out at what point when the days get shorter that gets triggered. But you can definitely tell that daylight has something to do with it, or at least in my opinion, it does. So when you're looking at the October then and you go into the fall, when you think of fall big time tournaments, you think of guys chasing bait back and forth. You know, you're going down the bank with a whopper plopper. Jimmy Watt did that a couple of times. I think it was like on Table Rock, places like that. How do the fish, generically speaking, act in the fall on Lake Hannah?
Yeah, so it's, you know, it is a lot of the kind of like textbook things you hear about fall, like covering water. There's a lot of situations where you have to do that. But again, just my experience on the lake is when you find one or you find a group, there's always more. But this is a time of year where I find you can get a lot of your bigger bites, you know, a one-off fish that's holding to a specific piece of cover, are getting a topwater bite still. Like topwater is still working right now. Like great. I've caught fish on topwater, you know, within the past week, the last time I was out there on a whopper plopper. I think the fish are, again, if you find one, and this kind of goes by like size to me, they're not in the summer or the winter thing where if you find, you know, a 6-pounder, there's going to be some fives, fours, maybe another six in that area. The ones that are close together right now are kind of like your cookie cutter 1-3s. So if you catch a fish like that, chances are there's a lot more around there and you're around bait. But it seems like your bigger bites and your more aggressive fish kind of seem, for me, at least in the fall, Anna, are more one-off fish.
So you're basically hunting then for that winning bag versus getting on a generic pattern, or is the pattern finding those one-off fish?
Yeah. So there's a lot of different fall patterns, and I'm not a big dock fisherman on Anna. I'm not. And I even tell people I go out with, there's always fish on docks. You can always catch fish on docks. The fish that are on docks on Anna are very, very pressured, but you can run like a jig skipping pattern in the fall on Anna that you can catch some really big fish. You can do that. So there is a pattern to it, but yeah. And I mean, again, I think it's super situational. The fall is so, so sporadic for me, where I feel like in the spring, if I catch something on a Nico rig, on a, you know, fish that's like pre-spawn or pretty much about to spawn, I can run that same thing all over the lake, like a pattern. And in the summer, if I find them in 10 to 15 foot offshore on some piece of structure, I can just run around the lake and make pit stops all along and pattern them. In the fall, it seems way less patternable to me. It's more about finding the bait, finding the fish, and then, you know, figuring out what they're going to eat that day. And again, I'm still relying heavily on forward facing, even in the fall, in a way to even just find bait and just watch how they're going to react to what I'm throwing to them, and then dial in my approach that way.
So honestly, you're describing junk fishing. Is that kind of accurate?
Yeah, I think fall is junk fishing. That's to me, that's what I look at it. I think it's the time when I, besides times in the spring when I junk fish the most, summer, winter, I got it pretty dialed. But in the spring and the fall, things are changing, things are happening. Wait, it's those transition periods. And I think junk fishing comes into play, you know, a lot in the fall, especially even, you know, for the past month and even for probably a few more weeks now until it really does get cold.
And then as always, guys, please give this thing a thumbs up. Please subscribe to the YouTube channel. It really helps us out in the algorithm. And then best questions are going to be winning some gift cards to Jake Bait and Tackle. We have one good one right here that just won a gift card. Daniel McClure. Daniel, you just want a gift card to Jake's Bait and Tackle. Message me on Instagram, Facebook, or you can email me and I'll get it to you this week. How much of the shad and bass go up lake into rivers versus creeks? And I just want to pause right there before you answer that. That's such a great question because every time I read a Bassmaster when I was younger, and it was the fall edition, that's what they talked about. It's like, you have to go up the creek, you have to go up the river, because mm-hmm. Bass said so.
Yeah, so for my opinion on Anna, it's equal. They're going to run up both splits, up the river, up the creeks, up, contrary, up to the big creek arms. So there's not, for me to quantify that, it's not, I don't think one's better than the other necessarily. You're going to find them in both places, so it's worth checking both out. And then again, to something I said, and this is pretty important as far on Anna and a lot of other bodies of water, is you don't have to run to the back of the creeks to find them. There's little small feeder creeks that are a little more hidden, you could say, that people aren't really thinking about, that are like right off Main Lake, and the fish are there, the bait's there for the same reason that they're running up river back to creeks to find that more oxygenated, more comfortable water.
Well, then let's redefine that. What, in your opinion, is a feeder creek?
Yeah, so I don't want to get too like on this, but if you look at a map, you can find them on the lake. I mean, they're everywhere. Again, some of them aren't even, if you just look on a map and you find any creek that flows into Anna, you're going to see it's not all of them are these big creeks. Like Contrary Creek is, that's always the biggest one. I spent a lot of time in Contrary. So that's the one that's a feeder creek, and it is the biggest creek, feeding in. That's not up one of, all up one of the north ends of the lake that I don't spend much time on, but you can find little like farm feeder creeks, and even little ditches and creeks that run off of the creeks that come into the lake at a different area that aren't, way back up into the back of a creek.
And then this is all with the caveat that no matter what, it's not about the best structure, it's about the bait, correct? Is it 100% you're looking for bait first, bass second, when you're checking creeks out?
When you're looking back in creeks, for sure. Yeah. So I'm going to find the bait first, and then I'm going to find what they're doing specifically on that day after I find the bait. Bait absolutely comes first.
Yes. So example is Tyler goes to a secret creek, but there's no bait there the day before a tournament. Is that still in your rotation? Or at that point, if there's nothing, you're okay.
Not this time of year. Spring, yeah, not this time of year.
Interesting. Yeah, I think that's good advice. And then honestly, I think we've probably mentioned this on the show a couple of times, but can you have too much bait? Like, what is the magic sauce for you?
Yeah, you can have way too much. It's hard to compete with the real thing. If you have... I mean, there's times where if you're on the right spot, you could like walk across the water on bait, and good luck. You have to be around a massive school that's very active, very feeding in that moment. And in that, I'm throwing top water. I'm throwing something noisy, something big, something that's going to get the attention away from. That's actually the time where me personally, I don't match the hatch at all. I want something that stands out. If I'm seeing a lot of bait and active fish, but it can work against you. I mean, it's always, I learned that lesson at a very young age. It's really hard to compete against the real thing in the fall when you're around a lot of bait. So you're better off finding less bait that has active fish around it, which again is time consuming. And that is why, covering water this time of year is so important.
No, I tend to agree with that. How long does bait, and just, I guess, a high level thing, If you are, there's a big Veteran Day tournament coming out this weekend. If you find good bait in a creek on a Thursday, will it be there on Saturday? Or are you going to check that again on Friday as well to make sure it's there? Like how long ahead of the tournament are you comfortable saying like, yeah, it should still be there?
It should still be there. The lake is very low right now too, so it is taking away some of the fresh water that you would be kind of going in this time of year. But so if it's there in my mind and I just look and I see a consistent weather pattern or relatively consistent, it's still going to be there. And if it's not right there, it's still very close. You know, they're not going to go from in the back of that creek in that one spot and, you know, all the way to Main Lake or something in like 3 days, in my opinion. If you find an area with it, they're there, they're around, you're just, it's where that covering water again comes into play. You have a general vicinity, general area located. But keep in mind, what happened to the conditions? Colder, warmer, rain, no rain, overcast, that, like, where did they pull up to? What direction would they have possibly gone? Did you get a rain? If you did, I would probably go closer. I'd actually go shallower where that fresh water is still coming in, as long as the water temperatures are, you know, still relatively the same.
And then again, guys, as always, ask a question, win a prize, ask a question, win a prize. Travis Cyber here. In the latest Woods and Water magazine, CC McCotter talks about the magic 55 degree temp. What is that all about?
I can only speculate because, I mean, that seems like a personal thing, but I mean, 55 degrees is, yeah, they feed heavy. And that's typically when you start seeing fish below that mark, they feed, you know, less, and they would start pulling more into their winter kind of holes and patterns in my mind. 55 degrees to me is almost like an indicator of the fall transition, the shallow bait chasing and all that is coming to a close, and they're starting to get more into their winter holes, wintertime spots. But I'm only speculating. I don't want to speak for them.
The Lake Anna Elite Winter Series starts in November. I had the date and now I completely forgot, but it's called the Winter Series. Mm-hmm. Will the winter bite actually start in November, or is there something else you're looking for? Like, I mean, it's not like a light switch, I think, where it's like, well, if it's November, it's the winter pattern. So like, if you could like forecast it, in your opinion, when do you think a true winter bite will start?
Yeah, again, it's all weather dependent and water temperature dependent. And again, with the shorter days, like you said, I'm a big believer in photo period matters more than almost anything, especially in the spring. I'd say like by December, again, unless we have some weird, really high warm front that keeps them from going to those spots. But I would say probably around December, like early December. Even you could even have it in November as well.
What do you think the weights are going to be like between now and going into the winter time for that first Elite Series event? Because if I'm not mistaken, the Dirty 30 was broken in January, early December. Are you going to be seeing those kind of weights now?
No, I don't think so. If you saw it right now, I'd be surprised. And you had a hell of a day. I think that stuff will start kicking in December, later December and January is when you're going to see those kind of big monster bags. February has the potential too, but it can also get weird in February if you have a warm February like we did this past, and you can actually kind of kill off that winter bite that Anna's become pretty notable for. But yeah, I think December, January is when you'll probably see your biggest bags.
Oh, we got some good questions here. All right. Looks like we got some gift card winners. I like this. So we have David Smith. You just want a gift card to Jake's Bait and Tackle. Message me on Instagram, Facebook, or send me an email. You can reclaim your gift card. David Smith, with the new hydrilla growing in some of the creeks, have you seen bass and bait fish relating to it?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's like one of my favorite ways to fish. That's a little bit, it's not everywhere, but there is hydrilla and there is some grass that's all over the place. Some of it, I don't even think is hydrilla. I don't know what it is. Some
spiders.
Yeah. Some of it is the stuff that like smells bad. And I know that the fish they stay around it, but they're not like in it. Like a fish will like get in a hydrilla mat. But yeah, there's hydrilla. One of my, you know, favorite spots on the lake that is pretty much good year round until the winter is based on hydrilla and the fish and the bait do. I caught a 7-pounder in hydrilla this year.
That's awesome, dude. That's so cool.
Yeah, on Anna. So it was, you know, it was in contrary. Not a secret there. If you find that same fish, then, you know, good for you. But yeah, it was in contrary and there was hydrilla in a spot that I don't think many people know that there's hydrilla at.
I brought this up with Odenkirk when we interviewed him, because again, guys, if you don't know, Odenkirk is the guy for the Department of Wildlife Resources that runs Lake Anna. It's basically his lake. And he is very grinning ear to ear that he's been able to get hydrilla back and get some balance in there. So you have hydrilla, water willow. And one question I asked him, which this is off my brain. Now that you have grass in the lake in a couple of years, I think the bluegill bite on the lake will get better because, you know, bluegill, generally speaking, are one of the forage species that is around grass. Do you think there's going to just be a better and better grass bite as the years go on if it stays?
Yeah, if we get this hydrilla to come up and some of this grass to come in a lot of areas, it's going to make that lake it's going to be 10 times better than it is now. I think that's almost more important than having the F1s. I'd rather have a healthy hydrilla, you know, situation going on any of these Virginia lakes. I mean, put hydrilla on Smith Mountain and you probably have one of the best lakes in the country. Put hydrilla on Anna, that's, you know, not going to choke out a bunch of stuff, which it won't. I think that's just people fear. Again, it's going to amplify the fishery by 10x in a few years. Your bait fish are going to benefit from it. Your bass are going to benefit. Everything's going to benefit from it. Everything's going to be more stable. And I hope that Anna's grass continues to do that, because fish are already relating to it. And some of them are big, very big.
Dude, that's so awesome. I mean, again, it is. The grass really is such an important thing for the ecosystem, especially in these older lakes. You have all the wood that's starting to deteriorate. It's getting cleaner. And having that blend of having the blueback, the gizzard shad, the threadfin, and then the grass population there, it really is going to make this place even better than it is, which is hard to believe. We got another question from Blake. I apologize if I butcher your name. Blake Herman. I think I got that right. Blake Herman, you just want a gift card to Jake's Bait and Tackle, guys. It's that easy. Ask a question, win a prize. Are big glide baits coming into play? If they do, what time of year is the best time to throw it?
I'm going to piss off the glide bait cult because I'm not an expert on it or anything, but I do throw it here and there. Like, I have a rod specific for it, and I've caught fish on them. Caught some good fish on them on Anna this year in the summer, which I don't think is the best time to throw them. In my mind, the best time to throw it is pre-spawn, and it's definitely pre-spawn. But yeah, you can catch, you know, fish on it for sure in the fall too. You can catch fish year-round on a glide bait, really. And if you ask someone who is more well-versed in glide baiting, you know, they'd tell you, yeah, you can catch fish on them year-round. But in my mind, and the best success I've ever had with big baits, is the pre-spawn, just when the fish are more aggressive. And you can't throw it this time of year to stand out or have something a little bit bigger profile. This time of year, I typically tend to downsize, though.
And that's interesting, because, like, is it in the wintertime, you go a little bit bigger? That's the ones that actually exist or that survive. Is it again, gets back to those weather patterns when you make the change to, like, going to a bigger bait? Because I know fall downsize a little bit. There's smaller bait fish that are stacked up. Is that kind of, again, going back to it, weather patterns when you make that transition bait wise?
Yeah, I think it's going to go more on bait, how the fish are active. And with forward facing sonar, it's so easy to figure these things out too. I mean, find a school of fish, throw a big bait, see how they react, throw a small bait, see how they react. So, I mean, you can figure that out in two casts, really, if you can stay on them on your forward facing, on a group, on an offshore group, which is tons of on Anna. It's very, very rare that you see a single fish on Anna. If you do see a single fish on Anna on forward facing, it's typically a better size. But if you want to test out what, like, the majority of, you know, those 1-3s that oftentimes you do need, especially this time of year, it's not just one fish swimming around. It's typically 5, 6, 7 in a group, and they're everywhere. That's what you see. There's never one fish, unless you're fishing a specific piece of structure, you're fishing during the spawn, or maybe you're fishing in the winter. Now they're pretty stacked up too. There's going to be single fish. But yeah, so you can test bait size like that. And I kind of do it like that. I try not to stick to anything, especially with forward facing. I definitely used to, like, it's this time of year, so I'm going to do that. I just going to let the fish tell me now.
I think that's so important to keep covering water, like you're saying, because, you know, again, unlike like the summer and the winter time, they're not sitting on just the brush pile. They're actually moving. They're constantly moving. Mm-hmm. And so you've got to be cycling through bait, got to be cycling through water. And I guess, honestly, this would be a great transition. Do you have some of the tackle or baits that you like to throw this time of year?
Yeah. So I'm bad about this because my boat is never with me physically, but I did bring two things just to show. And I probably showed this before, and I definitely slimmed this down soon too. I've showed this on there before. This is just an underspin on a spark shad. This is going to be good, especially in the winter. I downsized the spark shad a little bit once we're talking. This is more of the one that I think I have pictures on my Instagram of, like, one day where they're just choking this thing. So that's a good bait even now, but especially in the winter, just, you know, if you're rolling it over brush, over the top of brush, over a group of fish, that sort of thing. Another one I don't have one to show you. Everyone knows the Megabass Vision 110. I throw that. That's what I've been throwing probably the most on the lake recently. I love jerkbait fishing. I pretty much don't put a jerkbait down from the beginning of October. I fish it in the summer too. It's a really good bait in summer.
Good man.
I don't put it out of my hand until like April. And even I'll keep it in my hand in April. Like that's the first thing I'm throwing. That's what I want to catch them on. It's such a versatile bait. It doesn't seem like it, but like the cadence, the depth. And a little trick with that, this is something that I've done for a while now. Not something I discovered myself, but you have like the Megabass Vision, like +1, +2 with the deeper, bills. And in some situations and some lakes on certain depths, you do need that, but just use the regular Megabass Vision 110 and you change your line size. So you go down to like 6 is crazy. I do it if I really want to get down there, but use your line size to get that bait deeper, because you're going to get a lot more action and it's going to really do what the bait can do. Even with the lip design, that bait does not do what the regular, you know, Megabass Vision 110 does because of that lip and because of that resistance. So change your line size if you need to get it deeper, and just use that as the temperature is getting colder and, you know, fish are relatively going to be deeper. But for me in the winter, I'm throwing most of my jerk baits. I have one with 10 on, and then I usually have one with eight pound line on. And then I have gone down to like 6, and it's stupid. Like, do it if you want, but it's not necessary in my opinion. Just slow your cadence down. They're going to come up and hit, you know, that where that 8 pound one can get down to if you really work it. Another one of my favorite baits. So I love throwing crankbaits. And people like love them or hate them, but I love crankbaits. But so this isn't the exact, this is the one I'll throw a lot in the back of creeks and especially dirtier water. But this is a Fritz side. I know people are really either love them or hate them, but you know, they work. Just ask or look at like John Cox and what he does with one. But the important thing about this, and this is why I bought it, just because it's getting colder, is like the flat sided. So just, you know, less action, little wobble. I'm definitely gonna use it deeper. This is like the shallow running one, but they make one that goes down to like 12 foot or whatever. You know, you probably don't need that. And that, and cranking for me, is I'm definitely looking for hard structure on a sunny day when it's cold. If we're talking about winter on Anna, I like to fish like the rock piles and the stuff that is going to heat up from direct sun, relatively clear water, natural colors. This one's a little yellow. This is like something, again, I'm throwing when they're back in the creeks and I'm just trying to get something, you know, going or bang this off like a lay down or something. Just flat sided crankbaits. I think there is some truth to that, that little more subtle kind of thing as it's getting colder. You definitely want a more aggressive action in the beginning of fall.
I 100% agree with that. And because I'm a big time crankbait guy, I'm also old school, where I know tactical bassing has made popular right now the speed cranking, which does have a place. I like going to the other end of the spectrum, where I have a 4.5 old crankbait reel. And I think counting rocks also as it gets colder will be just as effective, where you're slowly just hitting every single piece of gravel down there, and just letting that thing load up on it. Guys, man, you guys are piling in some good questions here. Let's go. Brandon says, what size is the spark shad? Because that thing looked like it was like, what, 7 inches, 8 inches, or my eyes are going back.
This one's like a six. I think it's like a 5'8" or a six. So this is a bigger one, but go down to like, I think I'm going to get the size wrong, 3'8". And then I use like the very, very tiny one on a Damiki rig. And I also use a sonar shad on a Damiki rig in the winter. And that's not a steady retrieve. That's more of jigging it in front of a fish's face or dropping it on it. We use them, you know, forward facing or something on structure. But for the underspin deal, this is more of a bigger one. You could probably go like whatever the one size down is, which is probably going to be somewhere in the four and a half inch range.
And then what size is the underspin? Is that a half ounce or a 3/4, 2 ounces?
Yeah. This is a half ounce one, which again, a little bit, I think the last, when I had this bait tied on, it was like February. And I was fishing some deeper stuff with it, but you don't need to go like right now, 3/16 is fine.
Gotcha. Yeah. That looks like a Lake Fork like style thing there. The thing is so big. Let's see. So guys, you're asking fantastic questions. Thank you so much. Here we go. We got one from Justin B. Fishing. Justin, do you throw the jerk bait all day or do you tend to put it back down after a chilly morning periods?
Oh,
Justin B. Oh, I'm sorry. Continue.
Oh, I was just going to say all day if they're biting it. I mean, I'm not putting it down. If it's a really chilly morning and they're biting it, they're not going to stop biting it necessarily. Just because it warmed up a little bit. But again, it really just depends on what the fish are doing. If I'm not getting any action from it, but I'm a very firm believer with a jerk bait. If you make 5 right casts, you know, you can win almost any tournament. I know you could say that about any bait, but a jerk bait catches very, very big fish, and fish of all size, not all big. So it can be a limit filler, but a jerk bait can catch big fish.
I agree with that. And I'm so glad you mentioned line size, because I know on the opposite end of the spectrum of what you said, Patrick Walters was upsizing his line and then going with a bigger bill because he was fishing, you know, Lake Fork in the timber. Mm-hmm. And so he did the reverse of it. He needed to get it down deeper, but he needed the line size to deal with the size caliber fish. And so, yeah, playing with your bill size is such a important little way to kind of, you know, just tune everything in. And it's so important. People just do not do that at all. I answered that question. Sorry about that. Travis Cyber again. If I recall correctly, you stated last time that you were on the show that you aren't big on going way up the lake, but with this time of year, how far up would you go?
So you're never going to see me again, like way up in the back, like past like Thames, for example. Like I've done it. Don't get me wrong. And I've gone up all the way up Christopher's Run, and I've gone in the back, and there's great fishing there right now. There's absolutely is fish to be caught there. Don't not go there because I'm saying that I don't spend my time there. Cause there's absolutely good fish and plenty of fish to be caught when you go way up there. But me personally, and just my strengths and the way that I fish, I don't typically go up there even still this time of year. If you see me up there, it's like I do go up there. You know what I mean? Like you will see me up there at times, and a lot of it's just because I want to do something different than what I usually do. But I'm way, way, way more comfortable on that lake from about the first two bridges up on the splits and all the way to the dam.
It's so weird how we get these personal preferences as anglers, as we develop and mature, and what we're comfortable with. Some people only want it to be 6 inches of water. Others have to be 30 feet, and you can have success winning either way, which is always fascinating to me. Make sure I get through all these questions. And then guys, again, please hit a like. We're almost up to 50 people watching today, which was absolutely fantastic. We only have 8 people hitting the like button. Come on. This guy is the second coming for Lake Anna right now, and he's giving you absolute juice. We got Ben on. I got skunked on Lake Anna last weekend, fished everything from 1 inch to 30 feet. What seemed to be the magic depth for you this year, this time of year?
Okay. That's a good question. So one thing that I tell everybody, absolutely everyone that comes to Lake Anna, is you were I don't know, and I don't know how you fished it. I wasn't with you, but my guess is that your boat was on top of a lot of fish. So when you go to Anna next time, wherever you're fishing, just pull your boat off another 25 yards. You don't want to be right on the bank. If you can cast, and sometimes this is not true, but if you can cast and you can hit the bank or hit a tree, you are way too close. The fish on Anna are way too pressured. The ones that are up that shallow are very, very smart. Very, very smart. And you have to hit them at the right time with the right cast, with the right bait, or have something very dialed in. So the magic depth for me is, if I had to pick between two ranges on Anna, it would be, that's a tough one, but I think you could stay between 6 and 15 foot year round on Anna and still catch fish. And I say that with a little hesitation, because I would like to say 20 or something, or even I fish sometimes in 28 foot. But if your boat is in 6 foot of water, you are way too close to the bank, way too shallow. Now, if you're off the bank, way far off the bank, and you're in 6 foot of water, you're in a good spot and you need to fan cast around. Try to get used to not having a visual reference like a bank, a dock, or something to cast it around, and you will catch a lot more fish on Anna, because they are, for the most part, not on the bank. They're not. They are way, way off of it, and there's tons of areas. Look at your map and find areas where it's between 4 to 13, 14 foot drags out very far, where you can be away from that and you wouldn't even be able to make a cast and hit the bank, and explore those areas and just get comfortable making fan casts and finding bait popping up. And if you have forward facing, it makes it 10 times easier, but you absolutely don't need it. You do not need it. You just need to have that general area, that general map, and explore it.
And that is such an interesting question, where I feel like as anglers, as teachers, you have to ask this question first. When somebody asks you this question, it's like, do you have forward facing center or do you not? Because it's almost like,
I almost feel
like it's two separate pieces of advice that you could give. I mean, I want to do that exercise right now. Like if Ben had forward facing sonar, is the advice different than if he didn't?
No, it's the exact same, but I could give you a lot more details on what to look for and how to target and seeing the fish and getting certain indicators that would let me know exactly what they're doing. But you don't need it to do that. I've had plenty of people come out with me that don't have it, and I show them what I'm doing. Because a lot of the time I have to say, look, I know we look like we're in the middle of the lake right now. This might not be what you're used to, but here's a fish, I'll catch one. All right, now you guys go. And then I just get them comfortable with doing that. And then I don't know how many texts or emails or whatever I've gotten is, dude, I went to those spots, like didn't have forward, but just went around the general vicinity and used my map to know that I was in between these depth ranges, just cast it around, caught a limit. So it wouldn't be that different. It's just, you're going to be, unfortunately, and I hate saying it because forward, it's so freaking, it's stupid how expensive. I hate it. I hate how expensive everything in fishing is. But you're just going to be so much more efficient if you have it. Unfortunately, fortunately.
And then Ben said, huge shout out, Ben. Ben said, kayaking with no forward facing sonar, Garmin 3093 with side scan. I can't help you out there, but Ben, you just want a gift card to Jake's Bait and Tackle because you had a sad day of fishing. So hopefully that makes up for it. Instagram me, email, or smoke signals. I don't care. Get a hold of me and I can get you your gift card to Jake's Bait and Tackle. No, forward facing sonar is, dude, it's helped me out a lot. I mean, I made a post a week ago. We Butch Ward tournament up where we are, and I got I think it was eighth place. And short of it is, this is the best year consistency I've had with fishing. And one of the reasons is with live scope, I got to snipe two fish that never helped me in those tournaments. Mm-hmm. What live scope did was the information of getting the hell out of an area quicker. Yep. That to me, no one talks about. Everyone bitches about you see all the fish, not like, oh, this point's got jack shit. I'm not going to spend 30 minutes here, and you move. That's insane power for a good fisherman to have.
Yeah. No, that was the first thing I learned when I put it on, is this is a time-saving tool more than anything. I can't tell you how many times I can go somewhere, put it down and be like, all right, gotta go. And before you're casting, 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 you're like, well, maybe they're down there, but it's very, very quick information now that you can just see that stuff like you're saying and just go on to the next spot. I think that's the most important thing that it has, is it lets you know what's there and what's not in a way quicker fashion than before.
And the other thing interesting that I want to bring up with the live scope question, because this gets into some two questions that we have here. On the place that I fish routinely, it's a river run reservoir with smallmouth. And what'll happen this time of year is those fish are literally sandwiched to the bottom. And so you can scan for all you want and you see jack and shit. But then what you do is you drop. And then all of a sudden you drop it down and then you'll see them come off the bottom. So it makes searching and practice a little bit interesting because you've got to almost fish these areas to see if they're there. On Lake Anna, do they ever sandwich to the bottom, or is it pretty easy to find out where they're at with electronics?
So I know with smallmouth, I have heard and just like videos and knowledge and seeing that is a super common smallmouth thing of like hugging super close to a rock and not really being able to see it come out until you put a bait on. I've seen that a handful of times with largemouth, but for it doesn't seem like it's as noticeable as the things I've heard that people experience with smallmouth. I've never not been able to my knowledge, like not see a fish, even if it is relatively to the bottom. I definitely have seen things on the bottom that I was like, I'm not 100% sure. And I threw a bait in there and it rocketed, but I still saw it. It wasn't like it looked like nothing, like I hear with the smallmouth thing. And then all of a sudden they're like hovering up. So.
Yeah, and I guess to expand on that, so you'll have a ledge, or what if you drained the thing and it was back to river, you'd have your riffle system, and so you can see when a riffle comes and it's just this bump with nothing around it. You throw a drop shot on top of that little bump, and then all of a sudden when it hits bottom, they come up. So you're fishing the structure, and I've always found that interesting. Like you said, like is it just a smallmouth thing, or do largemouth do that? But that's good information. Let's see, and then guys, we're gonna segue. I want to make sure. Now, if you're a Patreon supporter, guys, again, there's tons of benefits that we have, according, like we do online tournaments, giveaways every single week for Patreon supporters, private chats, private live streams every week, and you always get your questions answered. They get to know a week ahead of time of who I have on the show. And Kenny had two good questions here. I want to make sure that gets answered. Oh, this is the second one. That's a little weird. Let's go with this one. When learning new water, particularly this time of year, are you using side imaging when idling to locate underwater structure and fish? I feel like I'm always fighting the urge to just start fishing when I should really use my electronics to discover new spots. So let's go with that first question.
Yeah, I still use side imaging to an extent. On Anna, not as much. It's still very helpful in finding bait. The only reason I'm saying I don't as much is just the amount of time I've had out there. For me, what I found is it's quicker, and I sound like a broken record. And I'm so, the forward-facing sonar to me almost has taken away side imaging on a lot of things that it hasn't had. But yeah, if I'm practicing at a new lake or something, like I'm gonna be at Smith Mountain a lot for the next, however many years, a lot more than I have been in the past, even when I went to school at Tech. So I will definitely be using it more there. But yeah, definitely side image and find structure. You will find brush piles. You will find different things. And again, stay within that range of what I was kind of saying, that 8 to 16 foot range, and you should be pretty good at start finding brush and different things on Anna. There is some deeper and there is some shallower, but again, a majority of it is in between those general ranges, give or take a foot or two. So yeah, side imaging is still, definitely important. It can be very helpful with finding bait and structure. So yeah, I would never not incorporate it, but I wouldn't rely on it too much.
When you're on a new lake, do you scan three or four places and then fish, or do you scan fish? Like, what is your process then for breaking down new water?
Yeah, I mean, I guess a lot of it, if I am going to a new place, I'm not even fishing for like a day, especially in a tournament situation. I am just like graphing and using general seasonal patterns, or like looking back on, you know, recent tournament results and kind of putting that together and, you know, process of elimination of finding similarities, you know, in the lake. And it's not like I'm scanning necessarily the entire lake. You still got to use a little bit of baseline knowledge. It's this time of year, they should be around here and this depth around that area. So yeah, I definitely, if I ever fish, like I fish like a handful of like 3-day events, but if I was doing one of those again, or like a really big, you know, long event, I would definitely spend a lot more time scanning. But you also do, you know, you have to fish at a point, or else all the scanning doesn't, you know, I don't think it does too much, unless you're scanning so well and you find an area and you find a huge population, a huge school, then, you know, maybe I'd make a cast or two, but I wouldn't mess with them too much in that situation.
Yeah, and you bring up the electronics, and I think it's interesting. If I could find this video, I'll repost it. This guy was practicing for the Toyota Championship on, it's not Table Rock, Lake of the Woods, one of those, you know, Ozark lakes. And he actually has live scope at his console with a kayak pole off the side of his boat. So he could idle past docks and quickly see which ones had bait, and then he could just mark it. And that idea of being able to see the areas and then quickly mark and move on, that's so important. And when you mentioned your term, when we fished college, we would put all of our stuff away, listen to a podcast, and you just idle an area until every stump was marked, then fish, and then you could piece it together, the pattern. Like, well, if they're on stumps, we just marked every stump. You know, if they're on docks, we just marked every dock. And, right. And that is so important, finding that balance for you of what works. Mm-hmm. Let's see here. We've got the next question. Next question is, again, from Kenny. Also, do you import the data from your memory card /graph to a laptop or desktop to review the data waypoints at home? I keep a fishing log, basically a simple journal to note the conditions, bodies of water, baits, and etc. Just haven't incorporated my electronics into the process yet. Any suggestions? I wish I kept a journal. I would be a better fisherman.
Yeah, I do. I do some basic like note taking on my phone for certain situations, and try to pattern it down to, I do a lot of compare and contrast between years and specific dates, and try to get that. Cause if I can go back and I can remember the conditions at a previous year, those same conditions might not be met until a latter date the following year, but I can remember that maybe it was April 4th. We had those conditions, I caught them this way. And then the next year it's April 15th and we're at those same type of conditions. And I can do that. So I do that, specifically in the spring. At summer and winter fishing, I don't feel like I need to as much. The fish are so obvious what they do now. It's just, it doesn't need that. But in the fall, I don't really do it for the fall, but in the spring I do it a lot. I actually find the spring to be one of the harder times to fish on Anna, personally, you know, early spring and like into the spawn. They're just more sporadic. They're all over the place. They have moved up shallow, and Anna fish are smart, so they're pressured. So, you know, I think that goes into a lot of it. When I can go off onto the offshore stuff and spend time doing that to these fish that are less pressured, that's where I do better. But obviously there's a point in spring where those offshore fish don't really exist, you know, maybe slightly, but not where you can do anything, you know, that great with it. So maybe that just says I'm not the best shallow water lake fisherman, which may be true, but I mean, I just think it's not, you know, pre-spawn great, but I'm talking like there's this window where they're spawning and all that, where, you know, it can be, you know, pretty tough.
That's only like 3-4 weeks, right? It's not a long time. It's just that's when all tournaments are.
that's when like every tournament is and all that. And you can for sure pattern them and all that in that time of year. But that's when I take the most notes, because I've been able to identify that that's when I can get spun out the easiest in the spring. And I did that. I was very consistent this year on the lake. I think I fished, there was one tournament I didn't catch a check-in out of the dozen or so I fished on Anna. So I've been very consistent this year, but I definitely had times where I struggled, and those are the times of the year where I take notes and I can look back. And then importing data and all that into my computer, I do that a little bit. I have a bunch of, I have over 1,000 waypoints on Anna. So I don't, you know, I have backups on backups, but I don't really go and look at them that much. I'll pull them up before a big event and narrow down, or I'll get a new card and try to import and put, go to my unit and make waypoints of just the ones I want to fish based on the information I have. But yeah, not, I think actually keeping information and looking back on conditions and things you do can be very helpful. It is very disciplined though. And mm-hmm. I mean, it's hard. I mean, it is hard to like write things down or take notes in your phone and all that after a day of fishing.
So what do you like, Dear Tyler, this worked in the fall 2 years ago. Make sure you download this waypoint next fall. Like what is your, like with 1,000 waypoints, like how do you break that down? Is it seasonal? Is it?
Yeah, a lot of it's seasonal. And like, I don't know, I can hit in an 8 hour day of fish. I mean, I can hit 100 if I want.
Jesus.
If I, if God, man. With forward facing, I can. Without it, I could not. With forward facing, I have a brush pile, drop down. Poop. All right, let's go. Drop down. Let's go. Some of them even will have fish on it. I just know they're not the right size. So I'm just going to the next one, especially in a tournament. Like I had a tournament this year with, I don't even know how many, we 100 something spots. And I think, and that was one of, like, we did pretty good. I think, you know, we were, you know, in contention to win that tournament on Tuesday. And we were just running, gunning, running, gunning.
That's so interesting. That is such a Carolina mindset. And it's so crazy when you interview a guy that fishes the Carolina blueback lakes and it's like, yeah, I burnt $6,000 of fuel and I hit 1,000 yeah. spots. And then you got the Potomac guy. It's like, I put my power poles down and I never started the big engine.
yeah.
Crazy different mindsets, man. Crazy different mindsets. Brian Henry, FF's Four Fishing Sonar has taught me to fan cast as a co-angler on the back of the boat and successfully pick up key bites.
100%. Yeah. Especially if you're with a guy that wants to fish really close to the bank and you are on a lake like Anna, you could turn around and throw to the main lake and be probably more effective.
No, 100%. And let's see, we got Daniel McClure. God, I hope I said your name right. I apologize. I can't speak English. Why does that lake seem you can only catch fish on one rock pile, dock, or brush pile that day, but it's rare to catch them even in the same week or close in time?
Like on the, so you're saying if you went to one, I'm assuming if you went to one piece of structure, you could catch it on a day, but if you went back to that piece of structure, they wouldn't be there. That's true and not true. So it depends on the time of year and if the fish are going to replenish there. In the summer, I can tell you I've gone to the same brush pile and all throughout different parts of the summer, different days, different conditions, and caught multiple fish in the same week. But you can absolutely go to a brush pile at the time that you're there and not see a fish, not catch one. But that doesn't mean that in 30 minutes, they're not going to be there. They were just out, a bait ball came by or something pulled them off. I think of a brush pile as like home base, and you're not always home. Sometimes you go, sometimes a few members stay, sometimes everyone goes because something happened, but they're always going to come back to that brush pile. If you find a brush pile in late June with fish on it, there's good chance those fish are going to be there for months in the summer.
And I think to get to your question on a more on the biology level about what's going on in the ecosystem, blueback herring, I really think that's what's done it. If you guys have ever gone to Lake Murray, Lake Hartwell, any of those big blueback lakes, it's here today, gone tomorrow. There's a population of fish that will stay in an area, and then there's a population of fish that literally just migrate. And so mm-hmm. if you have mid lake on Lake Anna, there are fish that literally will just patrol that area chasing bait. And so potentially that's what you, Daniel, you were dealing with, where, yeah, they were there because the bait was there, and then they left, like Tyler was saying, just chasing bait. And again, that's why this lake is so good for forward-facing sonar. I think it plays mm-hmm. very well for that. And then we got West Virginia fishermen. What tournaments are you fishing at Lake Anna? Who are you asking? West Virginia fishermen. Tyler, you go first. What tournaments you have coming up?
So I might be fishing this Veterans Day tournament. I'm not 100% committed on it yet.
Why not? Take our money.
Yeah. The guide thing is the tournament thing. I'll always fish tournaments on Anna. At the end of the day, I don't care, but it's a lose-lose situation either way. When you're a guide and you fish tournaments on that lake, like I'm way more interested right now to go fish tournaments on Smith Mountain or the Potomac or something like that than I am on Anna. But you know, this year, the tournament, the Sunday series, run out of fishtails every single Sunday. Great tournament series. Dave's a great guy, runs a great quick show there. You know, everyone's relatively friendly. You know, you might get some local looks if you're a new guy, you dress funny or something, but no one's going to do anything to you. It's all in good fun. The TBF, I fished the TBF and we had a bunch of tournaments in Anna this year. That's one of the reasons I did it. That was fun and cash a check and all those on Anna. And yeah, those are the two big ones. There's some random ones too, that I'll fish here and there. Just like some people that will throw together last minute. It's not official kind of thing, but for the most part, those two series.
Guys, when I get Dave on the show, I might try to do when the weather breaks, or maybe this winter, I'll go down with Tyler and I'll interview Tyler and Dave. I think that'd be kind of a fun little show.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. I love Dave.
Yeah, I've met him one time and he's a character. He's a really cool guy.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Have you ever thought about fishing the winter series?
Yeah, I have. Last year I didn't. I'm actually right now on, I don't get super personal right now, but last year I had some stomach issues that I had to go and get freaking tubes shoved down my throat so they could look in my stomach. And I was going to fish it last year and I just have like bad stomach problems. So I'm on like a health kind of binge right now and my diet is insane. I'm intense working out and it's the only thing that's been able to make my stomach feel better. So that's actually what I'm doing right now. And then just some other personal stuff where I haven't been guiding as frequently. I'm still guiding, just very selective. In the spring, summer, it'll open up a lot more, kind of like it did last year. So that's been the main reason. But I want to fish the winter series as well. I want to jump into a handful this year. Definitely have the knowledge and know where to do so and how to catch them. So, you know, I definitely will. I'll probably jump into a handful this year.
What's your diet like? Are you going like carnivore?
Yeah, that's what I want to do. I'm going through ketosis right now. It sucks. I'm not even cutting keto out carbs out completely, but I my diet has changed naturally. I'm eating organic plant protein, whey protein shakes, lean meat, vegetables, a little bit of fruit, but not even really that. Really, I cut sugar. I've lost like 20 pounds in a short amount of time, almost unhealthy. And now I've got it where my diet is better. So I'm losing weight healthy and I'm in like a cutting phase and I want to get in so I can start bulking up because I lost like a lot of freaking weight in a very short amount of time, but it made my stomach feel better. I don't have the stomach pain I used to have.
So I was doing a meal plan thing and I had stomach issues too. And then last year about this time I went pure carnivore. My knees felt better. My back felt better. I dropped a shit ton of weight, absolutely a shit ton, but I felt so much better. And then I started to put carbs and stuff back into it. And I started to get groggy again. And I don't know what the hell it is I'm allergic to because I got tested and shit and they can't find out. But when I go carnivore, everything goes away, but I cannot keep weight on to save my life. It's such a freaking nightmare. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Nightmare.
Yeah. And the carbs and all that, just from what I've done and the sugar that you'll get from carbs, that'll cause swelling. And, that's what I was feeling when I was guy. I mean, a lot of the weight loss started just naturally. I was never overly worried. It just happened. I was guiding, sitting in the sun with sun gear on for sometimes 8 hours. And then I wanted to fish the day. It would be like a 14-hour day. And then I just really started feeling it. And I'm like, I'm 26. I shouldn't be feeling like this. And that's kind of what, you know, the past like month for me has been a complete retraining my body. So hopefully when I am doing that and other stuff next year, it's going to be a lot better and I feel a lot better.
Yeah. I mean, hopefully you feel better and you got that six pack cause that'll be good marketing. yeah. Timmy, I've noticed when it gets cold, I always move from dirty water up lake to clean water down lake, and it seems to catch them better and they're built better. Do you think the cold front coming will help?
Yeah, I think it depends on how you look at it. So the colder the water, the more the fish are going to set up and be predictable. So dirty water can be good in the cold if you're getting direct sun, but I agree. That's why I fish the dam side a lot. I'm a clear water fisherman. And I want to get the best image on forward facing. And so I agree. I think it'll help. Yeah. I think if it's cold, I'm going clear water on any body of water. I'm finding the clearest water 100%.
Plus deeper fish, generally speaking, bite better regardless. The shallower you go, the more they're susceptible to just the weather patterns. I mean, I remember being down at Lake Kiwi for a college tournament and it was like 30 degrees, 20 degrees and blowing. We're catching fish in 50 feet of water. They didn't give a shit.
Oh, really? That's awesome.
That's an ocean, but you go up shallow. Oh, it's so much fun. And there's lakes you can practice on. And that's why I tell everybody, you know, that you're listening. If you want to get better at something, you have to go to a lake that specializes in that to get practice. Don't try to punch on the Potomac when there's very bad grass mats. Go to Florida, punch. You know, if you want to do offshore, go to a good offshore lake so you get the practice in. If you're in Northern Virginia, go to Lake Frederick. Lake Frederick, the biomass of blueback is insane. You'll see shit on your forward-facing sonar. Like, I mean, just try to help yourself out when you're kind of learning your technology.
Guys, I agree for sure. Oh, sorry.
No, go for it.
I was just going to say, I agree with that. The last time I went to Smith Mountain, I was catching suspended fish in like 70 foot of water off forward-facing. And that was like, that's what I like to do. Like, I love that. I love the deep water sort of thing, which is funny because the way I grew up was the opposite. But Lake Anna is a very great offshore lake. I know, like, but I promise you guys want to learn how to fish offshore, or you just want to step back a little bit deeper than what you're used to fishing, Lake Anna is a fantastic offshore lake.
You know, with that said, I'm having a boomer moment. What the hell was I about to say? Jesus Christ. With the forward facing sonar, are you seeing fish shine away, and what kind of tricks you have for that? Because I mean, I feel like we're giving everything cancer in the lake when you hit them with a beam from 40 feet away and they turn.
Yeah. So for me, I can't blame it on forward facing yet. I just think that it's the boat being close. Like I couldn't tell you if I had forward facing on or off, if it would make the fish do the same, because I've noticed like 30 foot roughly is where they can start, 20 foot. But I don't know if I didn't have forward facing on, would they have done the same thing just from trolling motor noise, the boat pushing water, making vibrations. So I can't definitively say it is because of forward facing, but I think it has a in shallower water 100%, because you can use it. I mean, up in like 5 foot of water on, I mean, I've used it to find like, you know, shallow. And I have what I think would have been the forward facing was something that made that fish go, but I can't definitively say, and I haven't noticed it in offshore situations yet, I think it will happen eventually.
Yeah. I think that's interesting because you hear rumors about this, online and, you know, Bass Blaster, Bassmaster, things like that. And then 2 weeks ago when I was fishing a tournament up at Big Slack, my home body of water, I was just scanning around and I got within 70 feet. No. Yeah. About 70 feet of this submerged log that was upright, and I shined to it. I saw them. And as soon as I hit the beam on them, they just literally just turned and left. And I was like, that's a little, it's gotta be because of my boat or something. And so again, I set it up to 100 feet, made a loop, fished some other areas, came back to it. I saw them at about 110 feet. And then as I got into that 70 foot range, they turned again. And I didn't know if it was my trolling motor, could be that, or it was like they started to feel the beam. And I don't know. It's just, it'll be interesting though to see if some of these bigger fish, because that's the thing I've noticed it on. It's the bigger returns that spook. The small ones don't seem to mind it as much. But
yeah, I can agree with that for sure. 70 feet, that's worrisome, because that's like, that is what I like. I hope that doesn't start happening on Anna, because that's like a magic, almost like a magic distance for me personally. I don't know if I even told anyone, but I love when I see something or a fish 70 foot away around that range in particular.
Is that the end of your range is 70, or you have it at
80? Oh no,
70.
No, I have it at like 120 or so. I have the new one, so it goes to whatever. But
you have the 34.
Yeah, I have the plus, the 34 plus. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So
No, go for it.
But 70 is just where I know I can make a super accurate cast in different ways and keep enough distance and change my boat position without spooking the fish. If I start seeing them spook around 70, I'm going to be like, but yeah, I mean, I've seen them at like 120 and I have that big topwater I talked about and I've just, and catch them that way too. But I like that 70 range, that 60, 70, 80 range.
Yeah. It's so hard for me to set it at 120 plus, because I feel like you lose detail. Cause I have the newer one, the LB30. Now granted, I only have a 10 inch screen. I don't know what you're packing right now, but it's so I can make shit out, but it's not the same detail as at 70 in.
No, for sure. 100%. I think even with this new one, it's still pretty good. And I think maybe if I had like one of those massive, you know, screens, it would be all right. But I agree. Once you get past like 120 and stuff, I don't think it's as clear. Definitely not as clear.
The Patreon question we have, let's see, from Darren. Is there much of a difference between a 10 inch and a 12 inch screen looking to get something for Black Friday? I have my thoughts on that. Tyler, you go first.
I don't know. You know, for me, it depends. How much are you going to use it? If you're a weekend fisherman, you're not super competitive and you just want to experience it, 10 inches is fine. 12 inches will give you a little bit more detail, clarity, more pixels, little depth. You can actually make up the size of a fish slightly better with more screen real estate between a big and a small fish. But if you get used to a 10 inch screen, it's fine. So I think that's just a personal thing. But if you're an ultra competitive fisherman, you want to get into it, you want to do that, go for the 12. But if you're, you know, just want to experience it and you go out every, you know, every other weekend or so, the 10 is fine.
Yeah, I tend to agree. So as you guys know, I have a 15 inch Hummingbird on the front for Mega, and I have a 10 inch Garmin. I think the difference between 10 and 12 is not as much. I think the big thing to save up for is the 15. I've seen a guy.
Yeah.
12 to 15 is such a weird difference, even though it's like I can do math. It's 3 inches. It just pops it so much more. So if you had 10, I would say don't upgrade to a 12, save for a 15 inch. If you don't have either, 100% go for the 12. But if you're trying to upgrade from 10 to 12, I don't think for the price it's that much of a difference to be worth the upgrade. But
yeah, I agree. I've used it both on a 10 and a 12, and I can tell you it's maybe, you know, 5 to 10% better. It's not, but I still would have caught the same fish on the 10.
Yeah,
I agree. If you have the big 15 and you want to like watch football and on the water and use it for live scope, you know, 15 on live scope will definitely be pretty crazy, and I could see that changing a lot compared to 10 or 12.
Did you see that guy on, I think it was Lake St. Clair, Ichiro, whatever, Fukudomi, who had like 3 live scope transducers for 3 units in like a pitchfork style? It was absolutely insane. So he could just...
it's nuts. Him and Koya Vegeta run like, Koya, I don't even know how many he has on his boat, but it's insane. He can basically almost see like 360 around his boat in live scope.
It's just, at what point is that, and is this just basically the beginning of the finesse era, when you watch all those Japanese anglers and they're now kicking butt even more than they used to with all these finesse techniques? This is, it feels like to me, like this is just the beginning. Like
it's the beginning of the finesse. That's what I started messing around with. One JDM technique that I don't want to name, but I'm happy to show people if they come out with me. And the other one is like the NU rig and some different like variations of hover strolling and stuff like that. And I saw pretty quickly that Oh, I was like, oh, this is what like I remember fishing was when I was a kid on this one lake throwing a big ass jig, and now I'm throwing this and these fish are like destroying it, like they've never seen it and all that. And so I think you do, you have to go like these traditional jigs and all that sort of stuff is gonna, you know, they're gonna lose out to like the free rigs and the more Vanessi stuff and all that stuff as these fish keep getting more pressured.
It's so interesting to me. And guys, this way, you know, drop your questions down below before we wrap it up here. Even just switching from threading a hook on your swim bait to just nose hooking it, it is such a little difference, but my God, for some reason, it makes the world of difference for some of these pressured fish.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree.
It, that strolling thing is so stupid. I don't know why that works. It is such a dumb design.
It took me forever to like get like even used to it. And just, it feels a little odd at first. It doesn't, it feels like you're not even really like fishing, or I don't know, but it works.
It works, but it's such a do nothing thing. If I didn't have forward facing sonar to help me dial it in, I would probably have not had confidence in it to be able to watch
for
it.
For sure. Oh, 'cause it feels like nothingness.
It does. And I think I was using too heavy of stuff. I was using, what was I using? Like 12 pound test to my braid. And then I dropped down to 8 and then 6. And I felt like I was actually getting, it was working a little bit better. And then you have to dial in the weight. Like it's a science to getting that thing perfectly balanced. But yeah, go get some YouTube videos on that, guys, that strolling thing. I'm not confident enough in it to talk about it yet, except yeah, it's got potential. It really does. So much of those techniques have potential, honestly. Tyler, you know, thank you so much. I don't keep you, you know, all night tonight. I know you're not guiding right now. When are you going to guide again? How do people get a hold of you?
Yeah, so just still reach out to me. I'm still willing to go out now until December. I just have to be very selective. I just have a few things that I just got to take care of personally. It's not that I don't want to go out with people. I absolutely love it. That's my favorite. I've never had a job that I've loved more than that. And when you do have that time out with me, you're going to get, you know, you're going to learn so much. I promise you that you will learn a lot. We'll have a good time. Just reach out to me still. In the winter, I'm still going to be selective, but I will go out. I'll show you how to catch big ones there. The winter time is, I can't guarantee you a big one, but I will show you absolutely what you need to do to catch big ones. I can't talk about that too much on this show. I'm going to piss a lot of people off if I go way into that, because some of that stuff is very, you know, a secret, and I will respect that. But I figured that deal out a little bit and understand that stuff. And you do have a chance to catch some big ones. I will be a little more selective with dates, but just reach out to me. And then once like February rolls around, it's, you know, it's going to be all go. Let's go Friday through Sunday for sure. And then some random days in the week, you know, we'll get out there and we'll absolutely smash them, almost guaranteed, especially in the spring. So yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to that. And then one other thing I wanted to shout this out. If there's anybody that is wants to get more involved with fishing and local competitive tournaments, but very low pressure, very fun, check out Lou's Fishing and Golf Club. So they do golf and fishing stuff. You know, those are a lot of the guys involved with that I've known my whole life. I grew up around the same area as me. Very nice, low pressure, everyone's welcome, low buy-ins, just kind of fun. You know, it's not overwhelming. It's a tournament you go, you can just have a good time. And they're great people. So just look up Lou's, you know, Fishing Golf Club, Instagram, Facebook, and you know, go out and try it with them. If you would just want to get involved in a more competitive spirit and you don't want to go drop a bunch of money to do it, it's a great way to do it.
Yeah, guys. And then I'll have Tyler send me the link to that. So when I re-upload this tomorrow morning as a podcast episode, the link will be there so you can click on that. Yeah, I mean, Tyler, thank you so much for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. Guys, again, link in the episode description to everything we talked about today. If you'd like to, please join us on Patreon. Our overall goal is to create a nonprofit to help stock our local waterways. Our first major goal, we're only 55 Patreon supporters away from hitting. So if you'd like to join us there, I'd appreciate it. Like and subscribe to the channel. We are the number one fishing show in the greater DMV metropolitan area. We'll see you next time on Fishing the DMV. Bye. You're listening to Fishing the DMV with your host, Thomas Ahrens. Fishing the DMV is brought to you by Jake's Bait and Tackle, located in Winchester, Virginia.
If that doesn't get you jacked up, I don't know what will.